All right, so let's pray again, shall we? Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this church. God, I pray that you would bless those watching online, all of us here, for those that couldn't make it today that are sick. God, we pray for healing. Lord, that you would just heal their bodies and be with them. And Lord, I pray that you would speak to each and every one of us here and those watching online this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So we made it to Luke chapter 9, verses 37 through 42. And it's the story of Christ delivering a little boy from demon possession. All right. So in our text today, though, he's going to deliver that boy who's possessed. And we will discover 8 keys to having prayers that get answered. So that's remarkable that the Holy Spirit talked about that this morning. That's great. All right. So in the hustle and bustle of our daily lives, we often find ourselves worrying instead of praying, right? How often do we do that? Okay, we have a challenge, and usually our go-to response is, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? Man, how are we going to get through this? Instead of we have a challenge, the first thing we should do is pray. Amen? Because God is for us. And even when we do pray, though, oftentimes we doubt that the prayers will get answered. I mean, we pray, but we're just going through the motions, right? Oh, Lord, heal Nani, heal Krista, heal Deborah, heal those that are sick, right? But are we really believing that he can do it? Are we having faith or are we doubting? What makes our prayers truly effective in drawing us closer to God and ushering his blessings into our lives? Well, today we're going to go through 8 keys to really having prayers that God hears. And that brings us to our text today. So turn, if you would, to Luke chapter 9, verse 37. On the next day, when they came down from the mountain, a large crowd met him. The next day after what? We covered it last week. The transfiguration, yes. When Jesus, his face shone like the sun, his clothes glowed, Moses and Elijah were talking to him for maybe a long time and telling Jesus how he was going to leave this planet. His ascension, really his death on the cross and resurrection. So 3 accounts, remember, of the same event. Luke 9:38, and a man from the crowd shouted, saying, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son, for he is my only boy." Matthew 17:14 puts it like this, "And when they came to the crowd, a man came up to Jesus, falling on his knees before him and saying." Again, we have the synoptic problem, but it's really not a problem. It's the same story told by 3 different point of views. Mark 9:17, and one of the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought you my son possessed with a spirit which makes him mute." Okay, all 3 of those could be right. He could have shouted from the crowd. He could have came up to Jesus and knelt before him. And then he could have just talked to him again. It could be. But that really doesn't matter. What matters is this is an actual event that occurred, and we're told the story of an actual event by 3 different witnesses. All right, so what happened? Mark gives us more detail, Mark 9:14. And when they came back to the disciples, they saw a large crowd around them, and some of the scribes were arguing with them. Immediately, when the entire crowd saw him, they were amazed and began running up to greet him. And he asked them, "What are you discussing with them?" And one of the crowd answered, "Teacher, I brought you my son possessed with a spirit which makes him mute." So back to our text, Luke 9:39. And the spirit seizes him, and he suddenly screams, and it throws him in convulsions with foaming at the mouth, and only with difficulty does it leave him, mauling him as it leaves. How many of you have ever seen or heard of someone who was demon-possessed? Anyone? It is rare in America. Okay, I've seen it twice, and we actually cast the demons out, and it was supernatural. On the mission field, though, missionaries often bring back stories of people possessed with demons and then delivered when they pray. I mean, so there still is demon possession. Verse 40, I begged your disciples to cast it out, and they could not. Matthew puts it this way, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic and very ill, and he often falls into the fire and often into the water. I brought him to your disciples, and they could not cure him. And Mark puts it like, and whenever it seizes him, it slams him to the ground, and he foams at the mouth, grinds his teeth, and stiffens out. I told your disciples to cast it out, and they could not do it. So what do you find fascinating about all three accounts? The disciples could not cast out the demon. Why should that shock us? We're going to get there. I want you to hold that thought. The disciples couldn't cast out the demon, but Jesus' reaction to their inability to cast out the demon is what is most intriguing. I mean, his reaction is harsh. Luke 9:41. And Jesus answered and said, you unbelieving and perverted generation, how long shall I be with you and put up with you? Bring your son here. Mark 19, Mark puts it this way. And he answered them and said, oh, unbelieving generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring him to me. And Matthew puts it like this. Jesus answered and said, you unbelieving and perverted generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring him here to me. Does that sound harsh? Okay, I want you to know this was a stern rebuke. Jesus did that often. He called them unbelieving and perverted. And then he said, how long do I have to be with you and put up with you? He was kind of put out. He's like, what? Jesus rebuked people many times. Remember Peter, when Peter said, surely you're not going to die. What did Jesus say? It's up there, Matthew 16:23. Hey, get thee behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me. I don't think I've ever told that to anyone. Except my wife. No, I'm just kidding. That's a rebuke. He did it often. What about when he drove out the money changers at the temple, John 2:15, and he made a scourge of cords? That's a bullwhip, folks. Can you see him whipping these guys, getting them out, turning over their tables, throwing their money to the ground? That was anger. And to the Jewish priest, you serpents, you brood of vipers, how will you escape the sentence of hell? And more people Jesus rebuked severely. Side note, it's not a sin to be angry, right? Jesus didn't sin when he did that. In fact, the Bible says, Ephesians 4:26, be angry and yet do not sin. And do not let the sun go down on your anger. And do not give the devil an opportunity. James 1:19 says, this you know, my beloved brethren, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. So we can't be quick-tempered, but we can be angry. It's not a sin for the right reason, at the right time, in the right measure. Does that make sense? So there is righteous anger. Do you know that God the Father gets angry? He does. Jesus got angry. All of us here in this room and watching online, at times we get angry, but get angry, the Bible says, yet do not sin, right? Okay, so Jesus rebuked them. So why was Jesus so mad? Oh, go back to verse 1 of Luke chapter 9. Same chapter we're in. And he called the 12 together and gave them, note this, power and authority over all demons and to heal diseases. So Jesus had given the disciples power and authority over all demons. That includes Satan himself. And the ability to heal diseases. Verse 2, and he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and perform healings. Jesus had already given them the power to cast out demons, to heal the sick. They couldn't do it because they were, Jesus told them, unbelieving and perverted. Okay, perverted doesn't mean what it means today. So I'm going to tell you what that word means. Okay, perverted, Thayer's definition, to distort, to turn aside, to oppose, plot against the saving purposes and plans of God, to turn aside from the right path, to pervert or corrupt a good thing. So Jesus had given them the power and authority over all demons. It's important the word all is there, because at the end of our text, 41 or 42 today, Jesus is going to say this kind, meaning this kind of demon, only comes out with prayer and fasting. Okay, but he gave them authority over all demons, but their lack of faith, their unbelieving heart, and their corruption of what Christ had given them prevented them from doing a miracle. They had the power but couldn't do it because of two things, unbelief or doubt. James 1:6 says this, but we must ask when we pray in faith without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord. So if you pray with doubt, it's not going to happen. Not at all. The disciples in our text today were doubting, unbelieving. And that's why they couldn't cast the demon out. James 1:8, being double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Just for doubting. We can't doubt. Number two, somehow they distorted, misinterpreted, or wasn't obedient to, or perverted Christ's instructions. So they not only doubted, but they fell away from really what Christ had told them to do. Yes, our prayers are blocked and ineffective if we doubt or are not obedient to the word of God. In fact, there's a few prayers that God doesn't hear. Psalm 66:18 says, if I regard wickedness in my heart, the Lord will not hear my prayer. The word regard there in the Hebrew is to see, look at, inspect, perceive, consider, or approve of. So if you are looking at anything that is wicked, what is wicked? Anything that displeases God. Does that make sense? Anything that's an offense to God. If you're regarding that, looking at that, thinking about that, constantly going over it, the Lord will not hear your prayer. John 9:31. We know that God does not hear sinners. But if anyone is God-fearing and does his will, he hears him. Sinners there is habitual sin, literally one who is devoted to sin, who makes sin a part of his or her lifestyle in disregard of God's law and leading. So if you're practicing sin, God's not going to hear your prayer. Proverbs 28:9, he who turns away his ear from listening to the law, even his prayer, is an abomination. God hates it. Hey, you know those times when it's like, man, I don't want to pray because I feel so wicked and evil? That's a good thing. That's the conviction of the Holy Spirit. That's when you simply repent, Lord, please forgive me. And as soon as you do, that sin is gone. It's cast into the sea of forgetfulness. You are cleansed, and you can boldly approach the throne of God in prayer. Amen? Okay. But if you're practicing sin, we already read he doesn't hear it. Micah 3:4. Then they will cry out to the Lord, but he will not answer them. Instead, he will hide his face from them at that time because they have practiced evil deeds. Practicing sin. Proverbs 15:8, the sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. I love that. That when we pray, when we're seeking God first in all things, we're being obedient to his word. We all stumble into sin, but that's not practicing sin. Does that make sense? I love that God delights in our prayers. I mean, delight there is to be delighted. I mean, he loves it when we pray. Why do you think it's so hard for us to pray? And I'm not saying you, but do you know the number? Pew survey, or maybe it was Barna, surveyed pastors. And the majority of pastors that they surveyed prayed 3 minutes per day. 3 minutes. Folks, we need to be a people of prayer. God delights in our prayers. Proverbs 15:29, the Lord is far from the wicked, but hears the prayer of the righteous. So back to our text, Luke 9:42. And while he was still approaching, the demon slammed the boy, him, to the ground and threw him into convulsion. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit and healed the boy and gave him back to his father. All right, Matthew adds a little bit more. Matthew 17:18. And Jesus rebuked him and the demon came out of him and the boy was cured at once. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, why could we not drive it out? And he said to them, because of the littleness of your faith, for truly I say to you, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here and to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible with you. But this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. See the what are those things called? Brackets? So that's in many manuscripts, but not all manuscripts. And we have thousands of manuscripts now, or fragments of manuscripts. So it is some of the most reliable manuscripts, but it's not in all the manuscripts that we find. So it's in a bracket there. But this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. In your Bible, it could be italicized, or it could be footnoted. It's not in all manuscripts. So, but there's a question whether that was in the original. Okay, but Mark kind of clarifies it. And Mark gives us more details again. Mark 9:20. They brought the boy to him, and when he saw him, immediately the spirit threw him into convulsion, and falling to the ground, he began rolling around and foaming at the mouth. And he asked his father, how long has this happened to him? And he said, from childhood. It has often thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. And Jesus said to him, if you can. I like that. All things are possible to him who does what? Believes. Who wasn't believing? The disciples. Why couldn't they cast the demon out? They lacked faith. They doubted. And immediately the boy's father cried out and said, I do believe. Help my unbelief. Ah. And Jesus saw that the crowd was rapidly gathering, and he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, you deaf and mute spirit, I command you, come out of him and do not enter him again. Okay, now Luke just said, and he rebuked the spirit and healed the boy and took his boy to his dad. Matthew adds this kind only comes out with prayer and fasting, and Mark is going to add a little too. After crying out and throwing him into terrible convulsions, it came out and the boy became so much like a corpse that most of them said he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and raised him, and he got up. And when he came into the house, his disciples began questioning him privately. Why could we not drive it out? And he said to them, This kind cannot come out by anything but prayer. All right, so that is in all the manuscripts. Okay, so we know that Matthew, where it says this kind only comes out with prayer and fasting, it is in some of the most reliable manuscripts, but not all. Does that make sense? But here Mark clarifies, hey, if you want to fight and cast out demons and be victorious, you need to be a man or woman at least of prayer. Are you with me? Fasting is important too. I would encourage you to do that. We need to be people of prayer. Here are 8 ways to having a more effective prayer life and seeing God answer them. First, mighty saints of God, prayer works. Matthew 7:7, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. Thanks for reading that earlier, Randy. Okay, when we pray, God's answer could be, you've heard this, yes, no, or wait, right? Okay. We could add that sometimes God's answer isn't what we prayed for. We prayed for physical healing, but God did a spiritual healing. We pray to ease their suffering, and they go home to heaven where there is no suffering. So your prayer is answered, but just not in the way you expected. We pray to get a particular job, but God knows you will grow more spiritually in another job, not the one you were looking for. You see, as children of God, if we seek Him first, He directs our steps. Amen? So the 8 keys to having prayers answered. Here we go. We need to pray according to God's will, not our wants. 1 John 5:14. And this is the confidence that we have toward Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us, and we know that He hears us, and whatever we ask, we know that we have the request that we have asked of Him. I want you to know this. We could pray for healing, but folks, I want you to know it might not be God's will. Are you with me? Okay, Paul had a thorn in the flesh. He prayed 3 times, and God would not heal him. He said, my grace is sufficient. Number 2, we have to have the right motives, James 4:3. And when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives. What's your motive in praying for whatever it is you're praying for? Number 3, we must truly know God can do it. That's have faith, not doubt. Matthew 21:21. Jesus answered, truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what has been done to this fig tree, but even if you say this mountain be taken up and thrown into the sea, it will happen. Number 4, we must be obedient children of God if we want our prayers to be answered. 1 John 3:21. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive from Him because we keep His commandments and do the things which are pleasing in His sight. God can't bless you if you're not walking the walk. As David said in Psalm 84, and you can read that later. Number 5, we need to pray for good things. And by the way, just because it's good doesn't mean it's God, or doesn't mean it's God's will or God's plan, or it will further God's purposes. Sometimes what we think is good is not in line with God's plan. Matthew 7:11. I want a Slurpee. No. And Jesus said, if you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask Him? And folks, some things we ask for, God knows that's not going to be good for you. We think it is, but God knows better than we do. Number 6, we have to honor our spouse and each other. 1 Peter 3:7, you husbands, in the same way, live with your wives in an understanding way, as with someone weaker. In the Greek, that word means delicate, fragile, valuable, easily broken. Since she is a woman, and show her honor as a fellow heir of the grace of life, so that your prayers will not be hindered. Men, if we're not honoring our wives, our prayers are blocked, hindered. They're stopped. And we have to, as children, honor your parents, or God's not going to hear your prayers. Ephesians 6:1-2. And we have to honor one another. Folks, I got to tell you, if there's someone in the body of Christ, and I'm talking about Christians, not unbelievers, that you disrespect or don't honor, God's not going to hear your prayers. If there's something they're doing that's not honorable, what are we commanded to do? Go up to them and say, you know what? When you do this thing, it hurts my heart. It hurts me. Or when you do that thing, man, that's sinning against God. You need to stop. You need to repent. And you do it and correct in love. If they don't hear you, then you grab one or two other witnesses and you go tell them again. If they don't hear that, then bring them to the church. And if they don't listen to the church, you don't even eat with them. So we don't honor someone who's not doing right things. Does that make sense? But if they claim to be a Christian, we must correct them so that we can eventually, when they repent and get their life right, honor them. We have to honor one another. Romans 12:9, let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. Not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer. Number 7, we have to delight ourselves in the Lord. I love it when we pray that God delights in us. So that's why every time, okay, man, I'm going to spend some time with the Lord in prayer, and then all of a sudden, you get a migraine, or all of a sudden the phone rings, or all of a sudden something else, and you're so distracted it's hard to spend time in prayer, because God delights when we pray, and we delight ourselves in the Lord. Psalm 37:3, trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and cultivate faithfulness. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him. He will do it. He will bring forth your righteousness as the light and your judgment as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. God answers prayers in his time. Amen? Not ours. Sometimes it's at the very last second. And number 8, we must seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Matthew 6:31, do not worry then, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear for clothing? For the Gentiles, the world, eagerly seeks all these things, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Don't you love that? Thank you, Lord. Yeah, every day. There are battles every day. But prayer is powerful. Pray for the big and little things in your life. Pray that you can do good at kickball, like Randy. And pray for the big things in your life, like your prodigal son or daughter coming home and reconciliation happening. God is waiting for us to ask. James 4:2, you lust and do not have, so you commit murder. You're envious and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. Folks, prayer is powerful. Prayer does things. Jesus gave the disciples the power to cast out demons and heal the sick, but they lacked faith and perverted Christ's instructions. To be a powerful prayer warrior, we must make sure all 8 keys are in place. These 8, if you want them. So if I'm praying for something, been praying, I fast and I'm praying and it's been a while, I need to make sure that all the keys, I'm being obedient, I'm doing all these things. Does that make sense? God's timing and answers may not always align with our expectations, but we must trust in his wisdom and sovereign plan. And folks, he does have a plan. Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. He is with you. He is for you. God is not only a God who hears our prayers, but he is also a God who answers them. Our faith is not in vain, and our cries do not fall on deaf ears. Psalm 34:7, the righteous cry, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. Man, do we need to be a people of prayer. So the summary is this. Stop worrying. Stop being filled with anxious thoughts and start praying. Amen? If we do that, we will see God's hand move. Philippians 4:6, don't worry about or be anxious for anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen? Why don't we stand? So, Father God, we know you're the creator of the universe. You wrote our DNA code. You know us, and we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and you knit us together in our mother's womb. Father God, we know you're for us, that you love us. So God, I ask this week that you would help us to be children who pray. Lord, it's so awesome that when we pray, you're delighted. So God, we want to make you happy. So Lord, help us to be a people of prayer. Let us run to you when every battle, every challenge, every unexpected whatever it is, comes along our path. Help our first response to be run to you for help, to run to you in prayer. And God, help us with those 8 keys. Lord, if there's one of those or several that we're not doing or something we should be doing, show us. Holy Spirit, convict us. And Lord, I pray that everyone at Living Water would be a prayer warrior. God, that they would be mighty in prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yeah, there's power in that name. Power in the name of Jesus. May God bless you. Sorry I went over today. I apologize for that. I try to end at 11 and it's a quarter after. Oh my goodness. Well, God bless you. Oh, Cheryl. Oh yeah, potluck next week. Go ahead. Breakfast. Yeah, who's bringing stuff? See, Cheryl or Debbie? Right? What do we need? Breakfast casserole? Eggs, bacon, you'll put it out? Okay. God bless you. Have a great week. I love breakfast. I can't wait for it.